like it was coming at you from all different directions, like every demon in hell had been released against your life, and every time you turned around, there was the devil doing something or saying something or being something. Well, let me tell you something. He can release an attack against our life. But Jesus said, in this world, you will suffer persecution. But I want you to know that the reality of the matter, see, we got to get out of the mental realm, get out of the natural realm, get into the truth of the spirit realm. When you learn to keep the devil in the spirit realm when he tries to deal with you, you'll beat him every time there. If you let him take you into the reasoning realm and dominate your thinking with his lies, or his smoke and mirror stuff that he does in this natural realm through people to try to communicate to you that God's not real or God doesn't love you or whatever, then he will beat you every time. Amen. It's true. Amen. So we've got to step up and grow up a little if we have to and see things for the spiritual truth, because the spirit realm is the true realm. That's one reason the enemy fights you to keep you out of walking with God. I hate to even use the word prayer, because when you put prayer out there, people think of all kinds of different things. But prayer is just simply walking with God, knowing God, a living, loving relationship. Right. It's believing that when he says, my sheep will hear my voice, that you can. Right. I don't know how to hear the voice of God. Start believing you can. Yeah. You know, any of the word doesn't work unless you believe it's true. Right. Yeah. Anything in God's word. We're told over in Hebrews chapter 3 and 4 here that we're not to be like the children of Israel who heard God through Moses, the prophet, saw God demonstrate himself in great power. It says, but they chose when the chips were down, when they were at the Jordan River, and when they were to go across and take their land, and even before that, in the 10 different times that they tempted God, they chose to not believe. You know, we think that God gets so upset because we're human and we have human flaws and failures and missteps and sins that we have to repent of. But that doesn't bother him near as much as refusing to believe.
Right.
And the reason that bothers him is because he knows you're not going to be able to connect with him if you don't.
Right.
These signs shall follow them that... Oh, I've never seen God do any of that stuff in the Great Commission in my life. Do you believe it? I had a pastor one time tell me, you know, that prophet, everything he's ever prophesied to me, I've never seen any of it come to pass. But yet the same prophet in my life, I'd seen pretty much everything he'd ever prophesied to me come to pass.
Amen.
And I don't know if I said it to him, I know I wanted to, but I said, well, did you believe it? Just because a prophet prophesies doesn't mean anything. Over in, where is it, 2 Chronicles chapter 20, they said, believe the prophet and you'll prosper.
Right.
Jesus said, if you receive a prophet, just because he's a prophet, you'll get his reward. We have to believe these things.
Yeah.
And the word believe, from a Jewish perspective, which is where the Bible's written from, when if a Jew, a believing Jew hears you say believe, what they understand, they don't understand. They don't, the American mentality would be, you have mental agreement with that. But the word believe is a verb, it's an action word. It means you live your life based on that. You think that way, you talk that way, you act that way. Faith without works is dead. Amen. And he's not talking about doing good works to earn something. He's talking about doing believing works because you believe what he said. You know how to defeat the devil in your life? Just keep believing. You know why we name this a believer's church? We wanted people to come in and believe. Amen. They may be an unbeliever when they get here, but if they'll walk with God and reveal or receive what he has for them, that'll change.
Yes.
But see, you can be an unbelieving believer.
Right.
You can believe some things about God and not believe everything about God.
Right.
Hallelujah. Amen. Praise God. Look at your neighbor and say, yeah, I'm glad you're here. You need to hear this. Surrounding the devil. The devil wants to make us think he's got us surrounded. Well, let me just destroy that whole notion right off the bat. Number one, when Satan fell from heaven like lightning, only one third of the angels fell with him. Only one third of them. That means we've got him outnumbered at least 2-1. And we don't know, but maybe there are even more angels that God has created since then. He's a creator. He can break whenever he wants to. Amen. I'm not teaching that as a Bible doctrine because I don't know. But for all we know, he may have done that. Amen. So we've got more on our side than he has with him, but we need to understand that the enemy, the only weapon the devil has against a Christian is deception.
Right.
He's a liar and the father of it. There's no truth in him. Even when he quotes scripture like he did with Jesus in the wilderness, he's quoting it out of a motivation of deception, so it's a lie.
Yeah.
Right. What the scripture said wasn't a lie, but the context he presented it in was.
Yes.
Come on, are you here?
Yes.
Praise God. So here in Hebrews, let's just look at something here real quick. Verse 1, chapter 1, I should say, verse 1. God, who at sundry times and divers manners, or different ways, spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he appointed heir of all things.
Yes.
What does Jesus own? What has he inherited? All things. When he rose from the dead, he said, all power. And if you look the power up in the word power in the original language, it means right and might. Doesn't do any good to have the right if you don't have the might. Doesn't do any good to have the might if you don't have the right. Well, he has the right and the might over all things. Amen? Whom he's appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds, who being the brightness of his glory, the Father's glory, and the express image of his person, and upholding all things by the word of his power. When he had by himself purged our sins, and when he went to heaven as our great high priest, and he sprinkled his the life of God, the blood of God, so to speak, because that blood he had in him had the nature and life of God in it. As he sprinkled that as our great high priest on the mercy seat and purged or established the redemption from sin forever, when he purged our sins, sat down at the right hand of majesty on high. Now notice, what did he do after, as a priest? Now a priest, if you study the priesthood in the Old Testament, priests never sat down in their priestly duties. They were walking around constantly. There was, in the furniture of the tabernacle or of the temple, there were no places to sit down. They were up about the business of ministering to the Lord and on behalf of the people, doing sacrifices, all the different things. Jesus, he was standing there, did the high priestly ministry, but then he took a seat. Now you study that in the scriptures and you'll find that sitting down means something's been accomplished and now you sit down in an authoritative place to rule and reign over what was accomplished.
Wow.
The Bible says that he is a priest. In this book, you read this book, his priesthood is after the order of Melchizedek. And when you study Melchizedek scripture, and I know I'm throwing a lot at you, I don't have time to go dig it all out and explain it. Melchizedek basically is this. It's a priesthood that is a royal priesthood, which means it's a king and a priest office. Jesus is King of Kings, but he's also our high priest. Consider the apostle and high priest of our profession, Christ Jesus. Amen? So here he is. He did what he needed to do to break the power of the devil over our lives forever. And then he sat down as a king. He took a position, and as we know in Ephesians, as the head of the body, in order for that authority and that power of what was accomplished in heaven at the mercy seat could flow down through him into the corporate body of Christ to institute that or to activate that and have that manifested in the earth.
Yes. Yes.
Hallelujah. A head may have, you know, your head, your brain, your meat computer, gives signals to the nervous system. The nervous system activates the body parts. The head may have the authority, but the head doesn't do the things that need to be done. It's the body. We on earth.
Yes.
That's what Paul is praying for them to get a revelation of in Ephesians chapter 1.
Amen.
So God can have all the power, which he does. Jesus can have all the authority. But if he can't get us, if we somehow are not letting the nervous system, which is the Holy Spirit's ministry between heaven and earth, we're not picking up those signals. We're not yielding to that. We're over here trying to function without the head.
Right.
All we're going to do is a bunch of flopping around like a dead body would without with his head cut off. We're not going to get anywhere. We've got to stay connected to the head. Lord, help me stay on track here. Everybody pray. Lord, help him stay on track. Jesus, verse 4. Being made so much better than the angels, as he hath by inheritance obtained a more excellent name than they. And then it goes on to talk about, you know, jump down to verse 8. But unto the Son, he says, your throne, O God, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness is the scepter of your kingdom. You have loved righteousness and hated iniquity. Therefore, God has anointed you with the oil of gladness above your fellows. Jesus, as King of Kings, Lord of Lords, our High Priest, is anointed with the anointing of gladness. This word gladness, you look it up, it means exceeding joy. God did not give us the Holy Ghost to look like we've been baptized in pickle juice.
Amen.
He didn't poison you with the Holy Ghost.
Right.
You know, exceeding joy. Why? What problems do you have? You don't have any problems. Oh, well, let me tell you, preacher. They're cutting my water off Tuesday because I can't pay the bill. And my spouse is acting like the devil. Well, I didn't really get on that one, but I'm not going to. This is happening. That person did this. And da-da-da-da-da-da. The doctor said this. Jesus, you have circumstances. You don't have any problems.
Right.
A problem would be something that couldn't get fixed.
Right. Yeah.
You don't have any problems. Not if you walk with God and listen to it.
Right.
And you do things His way.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, some of you in here, immediately when I said that, your mind went back, oh, yeah. I make so many I mess up so much. That's not what I'm talking about.
Right.
To err is human.
Yes.
God is not hung up on your hang-ups, so why are you hung up on them?
Right.
We are being made into the image of God.
Right.
Things are changing. We're progressively getting over ourselves.
Thank you.
You know, Jesus said one of the worst things that would happen in the last days, if you read Matthew and Luke where he talked about the end times, is that many would be offended. Oh my God, has that prophecy come to pass? People get offended over the dumbest things these days. It's just amazing. Now, why is that so dangerous? Because offense held on to produces unforgiveness. And unforgiveness held on to is a seed planted that produces a root of bitterness. And bitterness is, a root is, you know, a seed's one thing, but it has the DNA in it to produce whatever kind of plant it is. But if you let that seed, if you nurture that seed long enough in your heart and water that seed with your words and your attitudes, and that root goes up. Now that root taps into something and starts pulling life, starts pulling sustenance into that seed so that a plant can grow and out here in the seed realm produce the fruit of that seed. There are people that die before their time because they live in bitterness. Lord, I wanted to preach this other. We might have to change the title. I don't know. But see, the devil wants you to think people your problem. There ain't no people as your problem. Maybe you. You are your problem. Because you've chosen to nurture a seed of bitterness.
Right.
For me.
Right.
Self-pity is one of the most deadly things there is spiritually. Now, I'm not saying you weren't mistreated. I'm not saying that you don't have the right to say these things were wrong or whatever it might be. But I'm here to tell you that if you accept that and you live in that and you nurture that, it will produce in you bitterness.
Yes, yes, sir.
And bitterness will cause you to be spiritually blind.
Yes, yes.
It'll cause you to try to do God's job for Him in your life. It'll cause you to do a lot of things. And the Bible says that it'll even pollute people around you. Your children, your spouse, people around you will eat of the fruit of your life.
Right.
And what does a piece of fruit have in it? A seed.
Yeah.
You don't want your kids to end up as bitter as you are.
No.
You've got to deal with it.
Yeah.
You've got to get it out.
Yeah.
You've got to get some Holy Ghost Roundup, man, and spray it on that thing.
Yeah.
Get it gone. Round it up. Get it out.
Yes.
Deal with it.
Yes.
Yes.
It's true.
Yes.
See, when the devil has a legal right to produce that stuff in you, he'll keep doing it. And then, when the fruit starts coming forth, maybe the fruit comes forth in depression.
Yeah.
Just can't seem to get out of depression.
Yeah.
Maybe the fruit comes forth in sickness. Maybe the fruit comes forth in some other way. Strife. Oh, you know, you can't get along with people. And it's always their fault. I don't know why people don't treat me right. Listen, if you find yourself in a perpetual strife with people, it's your fault, not theirs. I'm not saying they don't have some fault or they don't do things or whatever. I'm not saying it's, you know, it's always everything about you. But if you find yourself in a pattern of constantly having trouble, you're going from one job to another or one marriage to another or whatever it is, it's you, honey, not the other person. I love you enough to tell you the truth this morning. I've watched way too many Christians go down in flames. There comes a point, it happened to me when I was 29 years old, where I stopped and I got real honest with me about me. And then I got real honest with God about me. Now, I'm not talking about you going around feeling condemned, beating yourself up. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about you being honest. There's a Christian song on right now here on Caleb. I think it was on this morning when we came over here. If we're honest. Just be honest. If you mess up, admit it. Amen. If you've got a root of bitterness in you, and you know you have this thing that where you just in your heart, the motive of your heart toward that person or that situation is negative, that is it's not gonna hurt them, it's gonna hurt you.
Right. Yes.
I know people that are still holding things against people that are dead and gone. You're not hurting them. They're either in heaven or hell. You're putting yourself through hell, but they're not even here, they don't care. I did ask for the Holy Ghost to help me this morning, didn't I? I don't know how we got all of that out of these. Oh, yeah, I do. Oil of gladness. The Bible says the anointing will heal the sick, it'll break the yoke. So if the anointing's not working in your life, it's not God's fault. He didn't come up with a bad bottle of anointing that day.
Oh, it's a bad shipment here. We better be cold.
If God's word is not working in our lives, it's never God that we look at and say, what's wrong? You can go to him and say, Lord, why isn't this working? It seems to me like, looks, and I've told him this a time, it looks to me like you're not doing your job. You said that to God. I didn't say it in accusation or anger. I said, Lord, from my understanding, that's what it looks like. Now, talk to me and show me. And you know, every time I found out it wasn't him.
Right.
Thank you, Lord.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Glory to God.
Thank you, Lord.
So we have to deal with these things.
Yeah.
Right now, we are back in the 1960s in our nation. I was born in 1951, I graduated high school in 1969, and I watched that whole 60s thing happen that took our nation down a wrong pathway of rebellion, actually started in the 50s in small ways.
Yeah.
And now we've got people in places of political power and in places in our universities and other places that have a one world mentality about things. It's actually a spirit of Babylon that's upon those people. And they're trying to push things in that direction. They think they're right, but because they rebelled against God years ago when they were young and never got out of that, now they're in a pattern that's going to hurt them and hurt our nation.
Right.
I'm not saying, this is not a Democrat-Republican thing.
Amen.
Our national emblem is an eagle, right?
Yes.
An eagle does what? Soars on a high place.
Right.
Has telescopic vision.
Yes.
It's in the Bible, in the scriptures, it's symbolic of the prophetic mantle that's upon us that we can soar with God and see the earth from his perspective, not our perspective down here crawling around on the earth. An eagle has to have two wings to fly, a right wing and a left wing. In our democratic system, our democratic republic, we do need the right wing and we do need the left wing, but they both got to be hooked into Jesus, the prophetic eye.
Yes.
So we can argue about this program, that bill, this thing, that thing, and you do need to study those things and see, do they line up with Scripture? Are they, the way God would do something and vote. But the big thing we need to do is get before God and ask Him, show me my nation, show me my life, show me everything from you. I want to soar with you like an eagle, not be a turkey walking around down here on the ground trying to figure it out.
Right.
Right. Amen. It's hard to soar with like an eagle when you hang around turkeys.
Yeah. I shouldn't have said that. Anyway, I wasn't implying anything about you. But I have been around some turkeys in my life. How about you? How do you know they're a turkey? They're always going, and they can fly high enough just to get up on a tree limb.
Come on.
Nope. Yep. Smoker. Smoker, yeah. Oh, man. Jesus, I don't know if this is me or you, but this message is a lot different. 1960. Thank you, Bob.
But see, you got to understand, time is linear, but history is cyclical. God designed it that way. He's always reminding us of that. He put us on a round planet. He has us look at a round sun. He has us look at a round moon. He gave Israel the seven cyclical feasts every year. They lived in this cyclical, they didn't run in circles. Now, if you don't do it the right way, that's what it feels like. It becomes dead tradition. Anybody over here ever feel like you're running in circles? We all have. So there's this cycle that happens. History repeats itself. You ever hear that?
Yep.
You know why? Because it's cyclical. And so here we are again. We're back once again to the 60s. Unrest, racial unrest, monetary situations. You just go down the list of all of the problems that we're facing right now in our world, and we're in that place that we were in the 60s. Why? Because the devil was able to take us back around to it.
Right.
And he's trying to produce out of it now what he produced out of it then. Now the good part is, God has a plan during that time too. And during the 60s, you go back and study the church, you'll find that of course in the 40s and 50s there was a tremendous healing revival after the Depression, after World War II. Many people were wounded emotionally, people were wounded physically. God raised up a mighty healing revival and brought healing to people that would come and receive it. And then when you get over into the 60s, the charismatic, what we call the charismatic movement began to happen. Gifts of the Spirit. God began to demonstrate himself and teach about the gifts of the Spirit, being baptized in the Holy Ghost, walking in a place of victory, walking with him.
Yeah.
And then over into the 70s began to be a teaching revival. People began to go sit, and I was one of them. They would go sit in auditoriums. I've sat in an auditorium with 10,000 people in Los Angeles and listened to the Word of God being taught under the anointing of the teacher from 9 in the morning till 10 at night. With a few bathroom and meal breaks. It was a move of God. It was great. It was wonderful. It was, you know, the Word was so rich and so good. And let me tell you, you've got to get the Word in you. You need to study the Word. You know, everybody in this generation wants it quick, wants it now. You know, I'll come into God's presence. Come, He fixes my problem, and I'm out of here, dude. That's not the way it works. You can come into the presence of God, He can touch you, your life can be changed, and I'm not saying that it's not a change that doesn't remain or whatever, but if you go back out in that world without your sword in the spirit realm, you will find that the devil is waiting for you out there, and if he can fool you because you don't know the Word, he can rob from you what you obtain in the presence of God.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's true.
And one man Jesus healed, he said, now go and sin no more.
Right.
Lest the worst thing come on
you
than what you were already into.
Yeah.
Oh, don't go and commit sexual sin or this or that. Well, of course you don't want to get involved in things that's going to align you with the devil and open the door in any way. But the main thing is, what you learn from Jesus, the Word made flesh, walk in that.
Yes.
I learned years ago to judge everything in my life by the Word. The first question I ask myself when something, a thought comes to me, or I'm approached by someone to want to do something or whatever, is what does the Word say?
Yes.
What are God's principles? What does His Word say? Because if it's not aligned with His Word, it's not God, number one. It's either a demonic spirit trying to gain access, or it's just a human. Jesus called them doctrines of men. He told the Pharisees, He said, the doctrines of men have made the Word of God of no effect.
Right.
The Word of God is power.
Right.
It has power in it to sustain. It has power in it to bless you and keep you and take you on and cause you to overcome.
Yes.
So if it's the Pharisees had lapsed into this self-centered, power trip, they had this religious con game going on where they were selling, secondhand sacrifices for top dollar prices. They were playing political games with the Roman Empire, and they had this whole thing. Jesus said they turned the house of prayer into a den of thieves. And He rebuked them. And He said, this whole thing is your fault. Because you're the spiritual leaders. And He says, your traditions of men have made the Word of God of no effect. No wonder people are running around saying, how come we read the book of Deuteronomy, what God said He would do to our nation, He's not doing? How come? How come? How come?
Yeah.
Praise God.
Amen.
Did you find Hebrews yet? Hallelujah. Look with me over here. Verse 13. But to which of the angels said He at any time, sit at My right hand until I make your enemies your footstool? God, see, what He's doing here is He's proving that Jesus and angels, because back in their day, they had confusion about the angelic. We're seeing it again today. You've got people worshiping angels and this and all this weird stuff. You see it on the internet about angels. Angels are created beings. They are created by God for a certain purpose. They're different varieties, different kinds that do different things. And they are servants of God. They are not to be worshipped. Read the Bible, you'll see that an angel, when someone tried to worship them, would not allow it. Amen? But there was confusion in their day, just like there is in ours, so this is being set straight. That Jesus is God, and angels are who they are. But to which of the angels said He, at any time, sit at My right hand till I make your enemies your footstool? Are they? They who? The angels. Not all ministering spirits sent forth to minister for them who shall be the heirs of salvation. Right. Who are those who are going to be the heirs of the fullness of salvation?
Amen.
You and me.
Yes.
You've got your spiritual salvation. You're born again. The life and nature of God's in you if you've given your life to God. Your mind, your will, your emotions, your soul is hopefully, as you walk with God, study His Word, you're renewing your mind. You're causing your mind, your thoughts, your emotion, your will to come into line with the cooperative work of the teacher, the Holy Spirit, so that the mind, what the Bible calls the mind of Christ in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, can operate through you, and you can have a mind that's dominated by the Holy Spirit that lives in you and the Word of God.
Hallelujah.
And then, of course, your body, the Bible says, is going to be changed.
Yes.
If you couldn't say amen on anything else, you need to say amen about that.
Amen.
You're going to get that resurrected body one of these days that Jesus got. Hallelujah.
Yes.
You can go have fish and drink the wine of the new covenant blessing in covenant with the people, but yet you can go right through a wall. I like it. Verse 14. Are they not all ministering spirits sent forth? Everybody say sent forth.
Sent forth.
The word ministering there means serving. Sent forth to serve or minister for them who shall be the heirs of salvation. Angels have been dispatched to come and to aid and assist us. So that we end up in victory in this life, not in defeat. Lord began to teach me about angels in 2010. This meeting we're going to here at Billy Grimm's, we had an encounter there. Well, there was like probably 1,500 people, I don't know, there that night, and they actually came into the building, but I won't go into all that. We talked about that before. We had them here one night as well, and we've seen their handiwork. But they are around you, ready and able. And in 2010, the Lord began to talk to me. And one of the things He said to me, He says that it's very important that my angels are going to need to do a lot of work and cooperative effort with the body of Christ in the days ahead. And He said, you need to learn how to cooperate with them and get them to cooperate with you. See, angels don't have authority on the earth. You do. Jesus didn't even have authority on the earth because God the Father had already, when he created Adam and Eve, said, take dominion over the earth. You rule the earth. I own the earth, but I'm making you my apartment manager.
Amen.
Right? And you study the Bible, you'll see it all the way through the Bible. Even Jesus, as the glorified Son of God, the scriptures say, as a prophesied about him, a body you have prepared for me. Did you ever notice that people that don't have a human body that functions lose their authority on the earth?
Yeah.
Right. Yes. To be absent from the body is, for a Christian, to be present with the Lord. Instant death, instant glory.
Yes.
If you're not a Christian, it's a different story. You'll go to be with your Father. Just like Jesus said to the Pharisees, who were playing the religious game, but their heart wasn't in it, and their heart wasn't right with God. He looked at them, and Jesus didn't lie. He didn't, you know, he didn't speak evangelistically. He didn't stretch it a little. He said, you are of your father, the devil.
Come on.
That's the spiritual nature that's in you. Amen? And when you die, you're going to go home. You're going to go be with your Father. If you know Jesus, you're going to go be with him.
Yes.
If you don't, you're going to go to hell. Yes, there is a hell.
Yes.
That's another thing people have tried to erase from this day and hour. Well, that was just an allegorical story that Jesus told about the rich man and Lazarus and hell. No, it wasn't. Every time Jesus taught allegorical things or parables, he started it with this. It is as if.
Right.
Or it's like unto.
Yeah.
But when he told the story about hell, he said there was a certain rich man.
Amen.
And he told the story about how that rich man, because of his heart, because his heart wasn't open and given to God, that he died and he went to hell. And he was tormented in the flame. Read the back of the book.
Yes.
You're just like me. When you get a novel or a book, you always jump to the back because you want to see how it's going to end. But God doesn't matter if you jump to the back and see how it's going to end. The devil and everybody that's associated with him will eventually end up in the lake of fire. It says where they will be tormented forever and ever. Well, I don't see why a loving God, he must not be a God of love. Or why would he do that? He didn't do it. He didn't make Adam and Eve sin, number one. And then he did the redemptive plan, covenant of God through Jesus Christ, and made a way of escape.
Yes.
And so if you hear the message and you choose to go to hell, then you've chosen, not him.
Yes.
That's true.
So you're either God's friend or you're his enemy. There's no neutral place in there. You're either for him or against him.
That's true.
Jesus said it, I didn't say it. Boy, he messed my message up. He said, those that are not gathering with me are scattering. You and I, if we're honest with ourselves, are either part of the answer or we're part of the problem.
Right.
One or the other.
Hallelujah.
Yeah. I'm glad you're preaching this.
Yeah, I'm No, but see, let me tell you something. You know, we're joking about this, but listen. This is the kind of stuff that will set you free.
Yes.
Yeah. People are running around trying to get free. What gets you free, let's put it this way. I heard Joe Jordan say this, and I remembered it. He said, full repentance brings full deliverance.
Amen.
Amen.
What is repentance? Repentance actually means to change your mindset. It means that you come to God and you say, I give you my spirit, soul, and body, and I'm not going to let my natural mind be dominated by demonic thinking and deception. I'm going to renew my mind in your word. I'm going to listen to your shepherd's voice, and I'm going to follow you.
Yes.
Now, the Bible says even a person who makes that decision, it says a righteous person will fall seven times,
right,
but rise again.
Yes. Right.
It doesn't mean we're not going to misstep or fall,
right,
or make a mistake,
right,
or even, you know, get into some mindset for a while where we're just, you know, struggling or whatever.
Right.
Right.
But when you get up again, how do you get up again? You say, Father, 1 John 1:9 says that if we sin and we confess that sin, you are faithful, which means you'll do it every time. And you are just, which means it's a just thing to do because of the blood of Jesus. For you, because for you to not forgive my sin, you would have to say the blood of Jesus is not enough.
Yeah. Right.
And the blood of Jesus is enough.
Yes.
You may not feel like it's enough. The devil may not tell you it's enough. Or he may tell you it's not enough. I remember him one time, you told God you'd never do that again. Now, that's a dumb thing to say, number one.
Yeah.
If you've already done it, you're probably going to do it again.
Right.
You know what I'm talking about.
Right.
Not necessarily everything, but, you know, if it's some kind of pattern in your life and you're struggling, you know, and you know it's not God, you don't want it there, you get a, I'm sorry, God, forgive me, I repent in Jesus' name, thank you for 1 John 1:9, I'm never going to do that again, really. If it's still a problem, you will do it again. But thank God, you can repent again.
Lord.
See, he's looking at the sincerity of your heart. He told Abraham, walk before me and be thou perfect. I read that scripture years ago and I thought, that's it, I'm going to hell. If that's the qualification, I'm done. But I found out the word perfect means sincere. I can be honest with myself, honest with God, and if I do make a misstep and the Holy Spirit in me, you don't have to dig it up yourself.
Amen.
You start doing that, the devil's going to dig up every dead bone that God has buried in your life and bring it up and make you think it's real for you today.
Right.
But when you do make a misstep, the Holy Ghost in you will go, ah, ah. That little attitude in you, John, what you said about those people, that's not too cool, bud. You need to repent. You're right, Father. I repent. I'm so human sometimes, Lord. He says, yeah, I know it. He knows we're flesh. Amen.
Amen.
But we can't presume upon the mercies of God. We can't just keep living in the flesh, living in the flesh, living in the flesh, doing our thing. I have a right to be offended. I don't want to go to church. Well, that's a favorite one today.
I don't believe you have to go to church to be a Christian.
Well, I don't believe you have to live in water to be a fish either. But you can end up a dead fish if you don't get no water. The water is not what's happening on the inside of the fish.
Right.
Jesus is in you. Yeah, you're his child whether you're in church or not.
Right.
But you receive something from the outside. Like that's what Priscilla was talking about today. Yeah. See, when she comes into this atmosphere and steps into her gift, God in her begins to move in her. And then all of us with her surround her with a corporate. There's this whole thing that happens here. That's why Paul in this very book, which we haven't got out of the first chapter of yet. That's why he said that we are to, and he used a strong word, that we are to tell people, hey, you need to be in church.
Yes.
You need to meet, you need to come together. There's a corporate dynamic that will bless you and keep you and help you.
Yes.
Now, if you're living on the boondocks and all you've got's a TV and you can't drive to church or whatever, if that's fine. God gets that. He understands.
Right.
But we need to find the place that God has for us. And a lot of people don't want to do that because as soon as they get in a church, they have to go through that process of becoming a person who knows how to work within a church.
Yeah.
Right.
Which means they have to start dying.
Yep.
To who they are and what they think.
Amen. Amen.
Thank God.
Killer flesh.
I might not have showed up if I'd have known he's going to have to. No, I'm kidding. Well, it's true. It's true. Now, I'm not going to say you're not, you know, a Christian or whatever. If you're not true. But the whole dynamic, the Bible teaches the pattern of sheep and shepherd.
Yes.
You need to find the under shepherd to Jesus.
Amen.
That is in your life, is supposed to be in your life.
Yes.
Yes. Well, Jesus is my shepherd.
Yeah, he is. He's all of our shepherds.
Yes.
But he has under shepherds that work and have a mantle of a shepherd that can help shepherd your life.
Yeah.
It's not what John Pursell thinks he knows or his opinion or his personality or any of that. And you better say, thank God it isn't. But when I stand up here and yield to what I know God is wanting to do through me as a shepherd, he shepherds people through my life.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I sit in my office sometimes and people are telling me their problem and I'm sitting there thinking, I have no idea what to say to this person. But you know what I do? I open my mouth and he fills it.
Yes.
Yeah. I'm honest to God.
Yes.
I hear things coming out of my mouth and I'm going, oh my God, that's good. Yeah. Wait a minute, let me write this down. I did it. Same thing's true of you. If you're waiting until you get ready to minister, you'll never minister. You'll never be a blessing. It's like this one guy You know, he had this big, huge food ministry, man. He was feeding thousands of people and praying for the sick and all these things. And this person came up to him and said, you know, I'm called to that same ministry. How do you start a food ministry like that? He said, well, here's how you do it. You go to the store, you buy a couple of bags of food, and you go find a hungry person and give it to them.
Yeah. Oh. Yeah.
Yeah.
True, amen.
Yep. Amen. Don't despise the days of small beginnings.
Correct.
Amen.
Amen. Lord. But see, the dynamic of the sheep, shepherd, and the flock, you need that.
Yeah.
Yes.
Number one, you don't have it all in you.
We don't.
I need it. I'm not up here like, well, I'm the pastor, so got my act together. No. You know why we have guest speakers like we do? Because we know that the Bible talks about the apostle, prophet, evangelist, pastor, and teacher in the leadership gifts of the body. I operate the pastor's gift, and I do operate prophetically as well, and there's an element of teaching kind of goes along with being a pastor. But I need the apostles' ministry. I need the evangelists. I need other teachers to teach me what I don't know.
Exactly.
I've noticed something about ministers over the years that I've known. Those that shut off other people and all they hear is themselves preaching every week, they end up with a real limited, narrow concept of what God's doing.
Yeah.
I listen to other people. I watch them on TV. I watch them on the internet. And they say stuff I don't agree with. But that doesn't mean that I throw them out like a piece of trash.
Right.
Amen. Sometimes I don't even agree with myself. Amen.
Amen.
You have to get things straightened out. It's all about growing and moving forward. But we need the corporate dynamic.
Exactly. Thank you for the word.
We talked about, last time I preached, we talked about corporate unity.
Yes.
We were over in Acts chapter 4, where Peter and John had raised the man at the gate beautiful. The government came after them, threatened them. They went to their own company, their church.
Yep.
And they told them what was going on. And the church, the corporate church, lifted up their voice in one accord and began to pray and ask God to offset this attack by upping the power. They didn't call Peter and John on the carpet and say, you guys have got us in trouble now. We're in trouble with the government. They're going to take our tax-exempt status away from us. See, what's wrong with us, and I'll admit, I've been as much a problem in that area as anybody else. We've been too quiet.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord.
We've backed up too much. Now, I believe in walking in love, and I know that a word spoken in the new season is like apples of gold and pitchers of silver. Right. There is a time to speak something. There's a time, you know, there's two scriptures that are right together in Proverbs. One of them says that you are to not answer a fool. I forget the way the rest of the verse says, you're not to answer a fool. But the next verse says, answer a fool. It's like, which one do I do, Lord? There's a time to say something. The Lord will prompt you. He'll show you. The Holy Ghost will show you. But we need to be bold about the truth. Our nation's in darkness because we pulled back. We need to make trouble sometimes.
Yes.
Not in a bad way. Sometimes we need to be the fly in the ointment.
Yes. Amen.
Yep. Amen.
Amen.
Oh, what do I do now? Does this help anybody?
Yeah.
Corporate unity.
Yeah.
Amen.
Amen.
Boy, I have some good scriptures here. They were neat.
They were neat.
Yeah. They were still neat. Neat, that's a word from my generation. Anybody know what neat means?
Oh, yeah.
Watch out, show your age. Groovy. Groovy. Don't go there. Bad dreams about that, huh? Maybe I'll carry my notebook with me. That'll help. Get over here, read off of it.
Yeah.
We still check that one?
No, let's just worship the Lord. Maybe I'm done preaching. I don't know. Some of you have been praying that I've come to that revelation. I think my wife's the main one. Lord, we praise you. Thank you. You know, so many times in our life, what we think is the answer is the opposite.
good directors.
You ever notice that God always seems to think backwards when we do? Jesus is that way. He'd walk up to people that hadn't walked in 30 years and say, get up. Get up, walk. Every time I've ever been in a tight financial situation, and I've gone to him about it, he's never, ever, since I've done that, said to me, oh, John, I'm so sorry. Somehow my angels just didn't do their job. I don't know what's the matter with those guys. We're going to have a team meeting with them. He's either, and usually has, corrected me in a misstep I've made.
That's right.
So I could get lined up with him. Because, see, if you can be aligned with the devil, and if you're aligned with him, he has access. He doesn't always come blasting in with a pitchfork and weird-looking horns and a tail. He very subtly is that little fox chewing on your vine to cut off the sustenance so your grapes don't grow. But every time I've gone to him in that situation like that, I talk to him about a need. He's always talked to me about a seed.
Yeah.
Now, that's crazy, isn't it? God, I have a need. Oh, you do? Well, give something away.
Right.
Wait a minute, Lord. I'm the one with the shortage. Not those people. Come on.
Yes.
See, God's got it figured out. We don't. And the answer to your problem, if you think you understand it and you haven't been before the Lord to have him lead you, you're deceived, I guarantee you right now. I love you, but I'm telling you, you're deceived. See, that's why we're told we wrestle not against flesh and blood. God knew, Paul knew, he understood. If we get in this thing of strife and we're trying to wrestle around in this world and figure it all out and it's going to be us against them, the people, and it's going to be this kind, if we live in that realm, the Bible says where strife is, there is contention.
Every evil work.
It's the word contention. And every evil work. That's why the Bible says forgive those who have hurt you or are using you wrong. It says forgive them. It says, not only does it say forgive them, it says pray for them.
Yes.
It says bless them. Why? Because that's going to cause God to be able to come into their life. Because you're operating the love of God, he flows in that river of love, and he begins to pour what the Bible says is coals of fire on their head. You know, I used to read that and think, yeah, get them, God. Burn them up. Crispy critters, hallelujah. That's not what it means. The fire of God purifies. Even the 120 in the upper room that had been praying for 10 days, waiting on the will of God, they had to have that fire come on them. To do a work, to empower them to go out.
Yes.
So you pray for that person. Bless them. Yes. Forgive them. Yes. Say kind things to them when they don't say kind things about you.
Yes.
And God just jumps right in the middle of their life.
Yes.
And they'll be as miserable as a frog in a frying pan.
Right.
They'll probably treat you worse. Because
yep.
The demons that are running their life are ticked off because you're rooting them out. You're doing something that's causing them to lose their authority in that situation. And so they're going to use that person to try to react more that way towards you, hoping you'll go, well, that didn't work. I better quit doing that.
Right, right.
Come on, are you here?
Yes. Yes.
There's somebody in here today. I don't know who you are. God didn't show me who you are. The answer to your marriage is what I'm talking about right now. That's right. Well, he, she. How about me?
Yes, exactly. It's me.
The Bible says that a woman, was it James over there? Was it Peter? Where it talks about her living right before the Lord in her marriage, regardless of if her husband's an unbeliever.
No,
it says God will save her husband.
That's right.
Why? He has the legal right to. If you're married, which if you're not, get married.
Come on.
God can't bless fornication.
Amen.
He has a hard time blessing fornication.
Yeah.
He has a hard time blessing adultery. Yes, those are still wrong.
Yes, they are.
I don't care what Hollywood has been lying to us about for a long time.
Sin against your mom.
Well, she's my wife because I love her. No, she's not. Well, I love her with all my heart. Well, Jesus didn't believe that. When he went to the widow of Zarephath at the well, and the Holy Spirit helped him read her mail with the word of knowledge, she said, I'm going to go get my husband. He says, you had five husbands, and the guy you're living with now is not your husband.
Yes.
Now, Jesus would have believed that I love them, makes them their husband or wife. He would have said, oh, you had five husbands. Are you, this person is your husband, I need. Got quiet in this wild world. Those chairs in that church. See, we think we can just, oh no, well that's just old fashioned. No, that is foundation. That those are ancient boundaries to keep you in a place of safety.
So true.
Yes, amen.
Marriage is a covenant between two people overseen and honored by God.
Amen.
Yes.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen.
Have you lost anybody on the internet yet?
I think you gained like two people.
Mom Terry gets that all the time. What are we talking about here? We're talking about making adjustments. We're talking about aligning ourselves with God.
Amen.
See, the angels want to work for you.
Yes.
They want to work for me.
Yes.
In 2010, when God showed me what he showed me and then began to teach me about that, if I had rejected all that and said, no, that just sounds far-fetched. See, some of it at first I was wondering about, well, I don't know, I've never heard that. But what I did was I said, God, show me that in the Word.
Amen.
And he'd show it to me in the Word. And if it's in the Word, it's true.
Yes.
It's real.
Yes.
God wants to take our lives into a place of greater glory. He wants to do that.
Yes, thank you. Yes. Amen.
But we're going to have to get our act together.
Amen.
If need be. If you don't need to, don't start, going out of here punching yourself in the face for some reason.
Right.
Amen.
You don't have to try to figure it out. All you have to do is say, Lord, here I am.
Yes.
Search my heart, know my ways. David denied the Bathsheba thing for 9 months. God finally sent a prophet in, stuck his bony prophet finger in his face, and told him a story, and brought conviction to David's heart.
Right.
Instead of David having the guy's head cut off, which he could have because he was king, he went in and fell on his face before God, and laid there all day repenting and seeking God, and he prayed. It's in the book of Psalms, I think it's Psalm 50 or 51. It says, Lord, search my heart. If I'm this deceived 9 months down the road, my God, what else in my life needs to be changed?
Thank you, Father.
God, search my heart, know my ways. If there's any wicked, twisted way that's not straight in line with you, lead me in the everlasting path.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
It's good to pray, God, where am I deceived?
Yes.
God, where am I wrong? It's not beating yourself up, making your... God loves you. He treasures you. When you just even look at him, it excites his heart when you look toward him. But he doesn't want you to give access to things that are going to deceive you and destroy you.
Yes.
Right.
Amen.
He wants you to live in a cycle of blessing.
Yes.
He doesn't want you to run in circles being chased by the devil. Like that guy years ago, he said, God testified, and said, I've had the devil on the run all week. He's been chasing me. That's not the way it's supposed to work. Amen.
Amen.
Praise God. Hallelujah. CJ, you didn't put the title of. Oh, actually, I guess this is surrounding the devil, isn't it?
Yes.
If you want me to change it, I can always change it.
We'll talk later. Hallelujah. Praise God.
Yeah.
Lord.
This help you?
Yes.
Glory to God. I just keep looking at my notes here and thinking what a wonderful message that was. Can I just say one thing? When Jesus was when he was standing before Pilate and he was there ready to go to the cross, he said this. He didn't say much during that time, but he did say this. So we're in Matthew 26, verse 53. He said, I could pray to my Father, and he would send 12 legions of angels.
Yes.
To spring me, basically, is what he's saying.
Amen.
Back during those days, in that first century, a legion was 5,000 people. 12 legions, 60,000 angels. Jesus said with one word. But see, that showed his character. Rather than getting mad because they weren't treating him right, he submitted himself to the cross because it was going to set somebody else free.
Yeah. Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you.
The victory is ours because of him. We're more than conquerors. But we've got to be willing to address and deal with things in our hearts. How many of you have heard the popular saying now? Don't judge me.
Yes.
Bring correction to somebody, don't judge me. Of course I'm going to judge you. Well, you're not the judge. You're not God. No, I'm not God. I'm not that. Thank God he has that place.
Yes.
But if I look at your life and I see the fruit you're bearing, it's not his kind of fruit, I can judge that. And if I love you as a brother in Christ, I will judge it. Not try to control your life, not put a condemnation trip on you, not beat you up in some way or condemn you. But the Bible tells us that we are to encourage one another. Or what's the word? It's a different word than that. It's
exhort.
Exhortation. Exhortation sometimes is a cheerleader. Six boot ball, rah, rah, rah. We can do it.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm a lousy cheerleader. You ever notice on TV when they have a football game, they shoot the cheerleader with one. Lord, we thank you for your word today. We thank you for the truth, because it is truth that sets us free. We know that you love us. You wouldn't tell us how to get out of darkness if you didn't love us. You wouldn't correct us as a loving Father if you didn't love us. We thank you for that, Lord. We are thankful for the fact that you're always there to embrace us. You're always there to surround us with your love. Your presence is so wonderful that we don't ever have to walk into your presence in shame, because the blood of Jesus is there to cleanse us from all sin. You've told us we can come boldly into your throne room anytime in prayer, because we're welcome and you love us.
Yes.
But we also can't live in some kind of self-deceived situation, blaming things on others, or even blaming things on you. I've heard Christians blame things on you you didn't have anything to do with. So, Father, we come before you, and today we just pray this prayer. Maybe some of us in here don't even feel like we need to today, but Lord, we pray the same prayer David prayed. Search our hearts, Father.
Yes, Lord.
Search my heart. Know my ways, Father, and see if there be any wicked, perverse way in me. Maybe I think I'm right, but it's wrong thinking.
Thank you, Lord.
Come and work in me, Lord. Show me what I need to see. Particularly in those areas where it seems like instead of living in a cycle of blessing, I'm living in a cycle that's doing nothing but wearing a rut in the ground. Like the children of Israel in the wilderness, so disillusioned, so depressed, and so having no future in their own hearts and minds that they even quit circumcising their children and bringing them into the covenant. God, we don't want to live that way. We want to live in that which you have for us. We want to see our families blessed, our nation blessed.
Yes.
We want to see things turn around and change, God. We haven't gone too far. But if we keep going, we will. And so we come before you. And Lord, we repent on behalf of our nation. I repent before you, Father, on behalf of my generation that started listening to the enemy. And I know there were some things that were tradition that needed to be rejected and needed to be changed. But God, we don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. We don't reject everything. And I pray, Father, for my generation, that baby boomer generation, God. Many of them are in leadership right now politically. Many of them are in leadership in our schools and in our institutions and in business. God, I pray in Jesus' name that you'll bring us to that place, Father, if we haven't already been brought there, of repenting for the past. Repenting on behalf of the things that were set in the wrong direction. And help bring us to that middle of the road balance of walking in love and the fear of the Lord. The reverential honor and respect of you, but yet walking knowing that you're a loving and a kind and a good God. We pray, Father, that you'll forgive us. Forgive us for the innocent blood that's staining our land through murder and abortion and the other things that have happened. God, come and help us. Turn us back to you. We look to you. We know you're our only answer. But at the same time, I pray that every person in here, God, you would begin to help us to step up and be what you've called us to be. Help us not to be that person that goes around trying to push people around with our doctrine, but yet at the same time, one that you can use to speak truth that might bring conviction or bring even some kind of a negative response, but yet it's the seeds of God's word that's being planted in the hearts of people so that they can come into a place of repentance and live a blessed life forever. God, make us the church again like we need to be. Help us to come into that place, Father. In Jesus' name. Heads bowed and eyes closed for just a minute. Is there anyone here that has never received Christ as your Lord and Savior? You've never prayed and asked Him to come into your life. See, the Scriptures teach us that we're born with sin nature, or we're born separated from the life of God in our nature, in our spirit. Jesus died and paid the price for us so that if we are willing to humble ourselves enough to acknowledge that we are a sinner by nature and we need someone to save us from our sin and our sin nature, and we come to Him and we are willing to give Him our life, then that puts Him in a legal position as that high priest, as that king, to give us His life. It's a great exchange. You give Him your life, which is that life that's headed nowhere but in the wrong direction, eternally. And He gives you His eternal life. and brings you in as an adopted son into the kingdom. If you've never prayed a prayer like that, we call it the sinner's prayer in Christian circles, but if you've never prayed that prayer, then today you can pray that prayer very simply. From your heart and sincerity, won't do you any good to go through some kind of religious ritual and thinking that something's going to happen because you did something. No, it's got to be from the heart. It's got to be sincere. Happened to me when I was about 12 years old, and I changed on the inside when I did that. When I prayed that prayer, I was changed by the Spirit. Is there anybody here today that needs to pray that prayer? Just lift your hand. Let me see your hand. I want to agree with you. I'm not going to bring you up here or anything like that. I just want to pray with you and agree with you. Everybody here know the Lord? Maybe you're here and you say, Pastor, I know him. I've prayed that prayer. I've asked him to come in my life. But I have to admit, I've been kind of doing my own thing in life, and I'm not listening to the shepherd like I know I should. Well, I've been there too in my life. But it's time now for you to open your heart and say, Jesus, I want you to lead me every day. I'm going to follow you. Whatever you show me, whatever you reveal to me as I read your word, as I spend a little time with you every day listening to you, asking you to talk to me about my life or what you need to talk to me about, that I'm going to walk in that path. I'm going to let you be my Lord. I'm going to let you be my shepherd. And I'm going to follow your shepherd's voice in my life. That's how simple it is. It's not complicated. It's just simply understanding that we need him. I pray almost every day of my life, Holy Spirit, you've been sent to serve me by leading me. I submit to your leadership today. Put your thoughts in my mind. Reveal to me what I need to know. And whatever you show me, I'm going to do the best I can to follow after. Maybe you're here today and that's the case in your life. You just need to make that switch. We call it rededication or recommitment. But you just need to make that switch in your life and you know it. Lift your hand if that's you. Praise God. Thank you. Thank you for being honest. God can bless and help honest people. So let's all pray this together. Father, we come before you. Thank you that you're my Father. You're my God. You love me with a great everlasting love. But I know I need your leadership. I know you need to be my shepherd. I need to listen to your voice and follow your path. So I make a commitment to do that today. I'm not saying I'm going to be perfect. I'm not saying I'm not ever going to make a mistake or miss it. I'm not even going to say I'm never going to sin again. But I am going to follow you. I am going to receive your correction. I'm going to receive your comfort. I'm going to receive your blessing. And I'm going to walk in the light of what you're leading me to be and to do. Thank you, Jesus, for being my shepherd, for being my elder brother, for being my king.
Yes,
I worship you for the Lord Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Praise God. Amen. Well, let's all stand this morning. Glory to God. I pray that this helps you.
Yeah.
If it made you mad, it's probably helping you. If it made you glad, it's probably helping you too. So just listen to the Lord. I'm telling you, he's the best thing that can ever happen in your life.